Welcome to the This Is Horror podcast. I'm Michael Wilson. Joining me is my co-host Dan Howarth.
Afternoon.
And John Costello is not here today.
How unfortunate.
we would like him to be another podcast with us, so we probably don't want to be too harsh on it. But he will be back. We'll be recording some podcasts later this week, in fact. So today we're going to be presenting an interview with Joe Hill. Dan was fortunate enough to interview him at a recent event in Liverpool.
Yep. Thursday just gone. Sold out event, about 50 people there in the brand spanking new Waterstones in Liverpool one. It was a really good night out, actually. A few familiar faces.
Yeah.
Controversial This Is Horror columnist Simon Bestwick in attendance.
Yeah.
Kate Gardner, Paul Kane, Maria Regan, Sam Kurt Unsworth, and obviously the legend that is Ramsey Campbell was in attendance as well. So it's nice to catch up with a few familiar faces there as well.
So, with that said, here is the interview. Dan Howarth interviewing Joe Hill.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the This Is Horror podcast. I'm news editor Dan Howarth, and joining me today in Liverpool Waterstones is the magnificent Joe Hill.
Hey, thanks for talking to me.
Thanks for giving up your time, Joe. So we'll jump straight into a few questions.
Yeah, sounds good.
You've been in England a little while now. Have you seen the sun yet?
You know, I would have been disappointed if I got to England and it was 80 degrees and blue skies and sunny. So, you know, all my hopes and wishes were met when I got off the plane and it was a downpour and has been chilly ever since. So that's what I hope for. You know, I mean, I'm only disappointed that I've been here for half a week and I haven't been knighted yet. I haven't seen a lake monster, no one in chainmail, a bare minimum of fog, not a single giant hound.
What kind of tour is this, Joe?
I don't know.
People taking you to the wrong place?
I don't know. I've haunted the train stations looking for boy wizards. Nothing. Nothing.
I hope you've had the obligatory photo at King's Cross.
One of the last times I was in England, I went to 9¾.
Oh, good.
And that was good, yeah.
Good. Okay, so we'll just crack on with a few questions.
Sounds good. Let's go ahead and do it.
Okay, not all your stories or books are what would be classed as traditionally frightening, so 20th century ghost or pop art. What is your main intention when you sit down to write a story or a novel? And do you find that now you're classed as a horror writer, your work comes with a certain expectation?
You know, it used to make me nuts. I was a kid who read Fangoria magazine, you know, faithfully, month by month. That was my Rolling Stone, was Fangoria, which of course was and is a magazine dedicated mostly to the art of, you know, splatter special effects. And it used to make me nuts when I'd read an article about some film and the director would say, you know, make a snooty pronouncement like, I don't really think of myself as a horror director. And, you know, the dude is directing Sorority Slaughterhouse 7, you know, and you're thinking to yourself, oh yeah, you're totally Fellini, you know. So I sort of hesitate to say this, but I don't really sit down and think of myself as a horror writer. I have written two horror novels. Heart-Shaped Box is very much, you know, a scary novel, and the whole idea of Nosferatu was to construct a book that would feel like a roller coaster ride in the dark. You know, I'm very comfortable doing that, and I'm very comfortable talking about those books as horror novels. You know, but I also think of them as novels with modest literary ambitions and stories of, you know, stories of character that could be interesting even to people who don't necessarily read horror fiction. Horns has often, my second novel has often been characterized as a horror novel. I don't really think it is. The viewpoint character is a man turning into a devil, and I don't know how something works as horror when the hero is the monster. I think that in a lot of ways, Horns is a tragic romance with supernatural underpinnings.
That's certainly the way that I saw it.
It's yeah.
In terms of a love story, really.
And,
you know, more than anything, that was what stuck out in the book for me.
Yeah, it has some satirical elements to it as well. You know, in a lot of my stories, you know, several of the short stories in 20th Century Ghosts are horror stories. Several others are sort of weird fantasy. There's a romance in that that book as well, called Bobby Conroy Comes Back from the Dead. You know, there are some historical pieces, and I've always enjoyed historical fiction and plan to write some. So, I mean, I guess what I would say is it hasn't changed my thinking. The idea that I'm identified as a horror writer hasn't really changed my thinking in any way. You know, it's great to write a story that scares people, and that's something I'm sure I'll do a lot more of. I'm a big, big believer in suspense. Suspense more than anything. I can imagine writing fiction that's not typically not something you would classify as horror. I can't imagine writing something that was free of a major, you know, element of suspense. Some, you know, because I trust suspense. It's what keeps people turning the pages.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, well, you've referred to it yourself in terms of Horns. You know, there's the love story that is kind of central.
Yeah.
Between Egg and Merrin. In terms of like your character interactions, I mean, I personally find them very believable. Are you the kind of guy that kind of sits in a coffee house observing how people behave, and that's where you kind of, you know, bring that in from? Or is that, you know, something that is just kind of brought through in the way that you've kind of read books? Is it?
I heard a story about David Mamet, that he used to ride subways and would copy down things people were saying. And David Mamet, finally, that rumor circled for so long and intensified to such a degree that finally David Mamet addressed it and said it was nonsense, that he had never once done that. Yeah. And I was kind of glad to hear it because I didn't really believe it. You know, I like dialogue. I like to write dialogue. Dialogue is I believe that reading action is exciting, and dialogue is a form of action, and a great conversation is often more thrilling than watching two people wrestle over a gun. Yeah. In fact, sometimes the right conversation feels like two people wrestling over a gun.
Well, case in point would be Social Network. I mean, that's a film where people just talk for 2.5 hours, yet, you know, it's a story that kind of drives forward from the start.
Absolutely. A lot of what works best in John Carpenter's The Thing isn't the actual battles with the monster, but the increasingly desperate arguments over how to figure out who is the monster.
Yeah.
You know, which also is a reminder of what Alfred Hitchcock talked about, which is the explosion isn't as interesting as the bomb ticking under the desk.
Yeah.
You know, the build up of suspense, waiting to see if anyone is going to spot the bomb, find the bomb, stop the bomb, is much more exciting than the bomb actually going off.
Yeah. No, you're absolutely spot on. That's a brilliant answer.
Thanks.
Moving on to your new book, Nosferatu.
Yeah.
In just some of the scenes in it. Incredibly harrowing. I mean, the phone calls from the dead children.
Yeah.
Christmas music being played in the middle of summer.
Yeah.
You know, makes the hair stand up on the back of your neck. But what is it that makes Christmas so kind of macabre for you? I mean, it's a strange time of year to pick to write about in terms of a novel that isn't actually set in.
Yeah, well, and that's the other thing is, of course, the book isn't really a Christmas novel. And mostly it takes place across a variety of summers. It's no more a Christmas novel than Shane Black's movies are Christmas movies. You know, Shane Black, of course, did Lethal Weapon and Kiss Kiss Bang Bang or Die Hard. You know, yeah. Die Hard isn't really a Christmas movie, but boy, it's sure fun to watch it in December.
Some would say it's the ultimate Christmas movie.
Some people would say it's the ultimate Christmas movie. You know, so there is this place where children go after they've been ruined by my bad guy, Charlie Manx. And after Charlie Manx is done with them, there's not much left except hate and teeth. And he dumps them in this frightening amusement park called Christmas Land. And, every morning is Christmas morning, and every evening is Christmas Eve, and you know, the fun never really stops. And Charlie just loves Christmas. And I guess what I was thinking about when I went to work on the book is a thing that Lon Chaney said. Lon Chaney said, "There's nothing funny about a clown at midnight." And I always thought, wow, what a great line,
yeah.
You know? And I think that the business of horror, the business of scaring people, is often about making these juxtapositions between what's innocent and harmless and what's deranged and upsetting. And, you know, Christmas music on December 21st is fine, you know, just late December, that's great. If you're out in the woods in the middle of the summer on a thunderstormy day and you walk by an old cottage with the windows smashed in, and there's nothing in there but darkness and cobwebs, and then you hear a voice singing Jingle Bells, you know, you're gonna run, not walk, yeah. away from that place as fast as possible. And so that's what you're looking to do, is you're looking to jar the reader with those upsetting juxtapositions. I also think back to another quote, which is someone talking about Toby Hooper and Texas Chainsaw Massacre. And they said it was less like the movie was about a madman, more like it was directed by a madman. And I always thought that's partially what you want to do. You know, you really want to, you know, give the reader the impression that there's a psychopath behind the wheel, and they've got to buckle up, you know, that they don't really know where this thing is going, but probably it's not going to stay on the road.
Yeah.
And I like to try to create that feeling if I can.
Yeah, it's brilliant. In terms of Charlie Manx, he's a central yeah. villain to Nosferatu. What was it that kind of inspired you to show your take on, you know, the vampire mythology and the culture, which, you know, some would say in a variety of forms has been overdone.
Played out, years. Absolutely. And that was part of where I was coming from when I started writing about Charlie, was my feeling that conventional vampire stories are completely played out, and I didn't want to write one. You know, so Charles Talent Manx III has been alive for over a century, and the way he has kept himself fit and young is with the help of his 1938 Rolls-Royce Wraith, which is a car that runs on human souls instead of gasoline. And by draining the spirits of his passengers out of them, siphoning out that spirit, he can put it into himself and keep himself alive. I wanted to write a story about someone who operates like a vampire, who feeds off others, but I wanted to stay away from the obvious tropes. I didn't want him to drink blood. I didn't want him to have to sleep on dirt. I didn't even want him to think of himself as a vampire. He has a license plate that says NOS4R2, or it's 4A2 in the American title. And if you sound it out, it spells Nosferatu. He's got that license plate on his car as a joke. You know, I wanted him to be frightening. And I don't think what we're left with vampires is very frightening or impressive. They're, you know, I don't know how they got sexy. It seems to me that there's nothing very sexy about a mosquito or a leech, and that's what a vampire is. I don't think sleeping on dirt is particularly erotic.
Especially.
I don't completely understand why they're all hanging out in high schools these days. You know, my impression was if you were in college and you went cruising the high schools looking for a date, that was pretty skeevy.
Yeah.
And these guys are way past college. They're like 600-700 years old now.
It's not a great look for people,
no,
like, is it really?
No, it really isn't. there is Nosferatu in some ways is a retelling of Dracula if Dracula was a car instead of a person. And we have our central bad guy. We have a Renfield figure in Bing Partridge, the Gas Mask Man. My hero, Vic McQueen, is kind of haunted and shattered like Jonathan Harker, but is still heroic. Vic has dealings with a punk rock librarian named Margaret Lay, who is kind of a Van Helsing figure.
Yeah.
We have an analog to Mina in Vic's son, Wayne. So the gender roles are reversed, and I've messed around with ages and times, and the whole mechanism of vampirism works differently. But if you scratch at the surface enough, it's kind of like a car that has a new paint job. If you scratch at the surface enough, you can see the original car underneath it, which is a lot of the same elements Bram Stoker was playing with.
Yeah. I mean, you touched on Vic McQueen there, and, you know, it's the first time you've used, like, a female lead in one of your books.
Yeah.
And, I mean, I thought she was an incredibly kind of strong character.
Yeah.
I don't know about you, but I thought if this was going to be filmed, like, as I was reading the book, I was thinking, that's Jennifer Lawrence in this.
Oh, wouldn't Jennifer Lawrence be terrific? She be great?
Yeah, she'd be fantastic.
Yeah.
But I was just wondering, you talked about change around the genders of people involved in the Dracula kind of story. What was that, a conscious decision from you to kind of have her at the forefront of the book, or was that just something that came naturally once the character kind of came into your head?
Well, I had done a novel called Heart-Shaped Box about a 50-something heavy metal musician, male. I did a story called Horns about a guy in his early 20s who grows devil horns and acquires all the powers of, you know, a demon, male. I wrote a book of short stories, 20th Century Ghosts. There's 15 stories in it. Every single character who's a lead character is a male character. And my whole career was starting to look like this one big sausage party. And on those grounds alone, I felt it was time to write about a female character. Also, I'm a single parent. You know, and I think that you know, the monster in the closet is frightening. The boogeyman under the bed is scary. Parenting is terrifying. Because every day there's a new opportunity to screw it up. And you know, the world is full of sharp edges that are just waiting to scar your child. And there's only so much you can do to protect them. And I wanted to write about that, and I decided I wanted to write about a mother instead of a father, because I wanted to do something that was different from what I had done with gender in the past. You know, I wanted to have that female lead. I also wanted to write about some aspects of motherhood that I don't think are often discussed, especially in genre fiction. Because usually in genre fiction, a mother character is there to pull muffins out of the oven and to dispense wisdom. And I wanted to write about someone who loved her child, but was maybe a reluctant mother. Maybe being a mother wasn't her first choice.
Yeah, there was an element of kind of taboo in terms of the way that she looks at a child, maybe thinking, you know, this wasn't the life that was meant for me.
Absolutely. There's Vic has artistic ambitions. She has had some bouts of depression and paranoia that she's wrestled with. She has a whole broken history of mistakes and regrets that she wishes she could take back, and a problematic relationship with her own mother. And that those are all things I wanted to explore. I wanted to say she's a mom. Motherhood is not the only thing that defines her. And that felt like something important to explore.
Sure. As you say, women play a central role in the book. I love the way that Vic isn't, you know, the typical screaming victim.
Yeah.
Throughout this, I just thought that was, you know, a really clever kind of turn.
And that's a James, you know, when I was growing up, that's a big James Cameron thing.
Yeah.
You know, I love James Cameron's films. One of the first works of art I became truly obsessed with was Aliens, which I saw over and over again. Later, I bought the script. I read the script several times and then deconstructed it to try to figure out why it worked. And in many ways, Vic McQueen is a very James Cameron type protagonist. You know, she's very much of the same mold as Ripley or Sarah Connor.
Oh yeah, she kicks a bit of ass.
Yeah, she does. She's pretty tough.
So as with some of your previous novels, the family at the centre of Nosferatu is kind of fractured and troubled, split apart. You know, is that kind of a reflection of something else that is kind of ongoing at the moment?
Yeah, do I want to unload? Do I want to unload something? No, I mean, no. I've been very happy. You know, I came from a great, happy family, you know, very close, tightly knit family. It's true I wound up a divorced guy, but I'm still real close friends with my ex, and you know, things have worked out pretty well with the kids and stuff. And I think that structurally, it's tough to write about happy people.
Yeah.
You know, if you start with a character who has everything and is really happy and content, you know, then you have to spend 25 pages taking it all away. Better just to start with someone who's already damaged. You know, and it's a little disappointing to say, but it's just happy characters don't make for very interesting fiction. You know, I certainly hope, you know, that most of my readers are happy people, but I think when they sit down, they want to explore, you know, more extreme emotional environments.
Yeah, of course. So it's nice to get that little break away from your unhappy life.
Yeah, well, right. One of the things you can walk away is, you know, you can walk away from a really harrowing story and say, boy, I have it easy. You know, but more than that, I think that even if your life is very happy, even if it's very content, we turn to fiction to explore some feelings and stuff in this, you know, in the safe playground of make-believe that maybe we don't want to explore in everyday life, but sometimes have to. You know, most of us aren't going to face a pitiless, remorseless monster like Hannibal Lecter who wants to eat our liver with fava beans. But some of us will have to face cancer in our life, which might want to eat our liver.
Yeah.
And will come for our life whether we like it or not. And no amount of pleading or begging will, you know, will turn off that disease. You know, and when we turn to a story like Silence of the Lambs or Nosferatu or whatever we're reading, it's partially rehearsal, I think, emotional rehearsal. And it's a way to begin preparing, you know, an answer to that question. What would I do if I was in a real corner, if I was facing a real bad situation? No one wants to lose a loved one, but so many stories are about loss. And that's because people need to deal with it. They need to deal with that possibility, you know, before it happens, and then after it's happened, they need to deal with it even more. And fiction gives us a zone that we can go to that's very safe and protective, where even if we're reading a terrifying, you know, horrible action scene or something where someone is being attacked, you can, if it gets too intense, you can put the book down and walk away and then come back to it, which you can't do in real life.
Yeah.
And furthermore, I think most of us can say, you know, this is terrible, this is terrible, I'm loving it. You know, and you're flying through the pages to find out what happens next, because it's also exciting, and it's also, on some level, you're aware it's play. So that's why I think, that's one way I think that fiction is very healthy.
Thanks for listening to my interview with Joe Hill. Unfortunately, I had to end a little bit abruptly because I was making Joe late for his signing and keeping in excess of 50 people waiting. I'd like to extend my thanks to Joe for giving up his time, and also my thanks to John Weir as well for his hard work in making sure that the interview happened. Myself and the rest of the This Is Horror staff really appreciate the effort that you've put in.
Dan, that was a great interview you conducted with Joe Hill, and it was actually your first interview, if I'm correct.
Yeah, thanks for saying so, Michael. Yeah, it's the first time I'd ever interviewed anybody face-to-face. So yeah, it was a little bit of a daunting experience when you think about, well, you know, Joe's, you know, a big name. So yeah, it was a little bit nerve-wracking to begin with, but he's, you know, he's a really sound guy, he's a really nice and down-to-earth bloke, so we just kind of went into the manager's office at Waterstones in Liverpool and set the equipment up, just had a quick chat and just, you know, got straight into it. It put you immediately at ease and, you know, as I'm sure the listeners will agree, gave some fantastic answers to the questions.
Yeah, and it didn't come across as a first-timer's interview. You weren't like a noob or anything, so, you know.
Thanks for saying so.
Well played. And yeah, it just came across as a very natural conversation, and as you say, Joe is a very articulate, you know, guy. One thing I noticed in the interview with Joe is you didn't bring any of your classic comments to the table, such as stitching up the chicken in American Mary, the shitty Vauxhall Astra in.
Yeah, that's true. I was on my best behaviour. We teetered on the brink of disaster, I think, when he talked about college guys going to the high school to try and get dates.
Yeah.
That was the opportunity in my mind where I could have, you know, taken it off track and down the more traditional This Is Horror podcast, you know, disgusting fare. But I decided to keep my professionalism and you know, behave well for a change.
Well, you know, we appreciate that you did that. You know, you waved the This Is Horror flag, and I think you've done us proud on that one.
Thanks very much.
So, did you get to catch up with him at all after the event?
Yeah, I mean, I apologise to the people in Liverpool that were kept waiting for 10, 15 minutes or so, because that was exclusively my fault for barging in before the reading took place. So it was an absolutely packed, you know, row of seats in there. There was, like I said, there was about 50 people there. And when I arrived, kind of running back up the stairs to make it to the event in time, they were playing the Christmas songs. And those of you that have been, you know, busily working your way through Nosferatu will know exactly why that was the case. So we sat down, and then Joe came out and did a reading. He read the extract that was actually given away with In the Tall Grass, the ebook version of that. He read the scene that was with the hospital where Charlie Manx is unconscious, and then he appears to come round and have a conversation with a nurse, which is quite a chilling section. But not only is Joe, you know, quite a confident and articulate guy, he's also really entertaining as well. So his reading was full of different voices and impressions, and he kind of brought his own personality into the reading as well, which was very entertaining. And then Glyn Morgan of Twisted Tales opened the floor up to questions from the audience. I think we got through about 8 or 10 of those, to be honest. A lot of them are centered around Lock and Key, actually, is his comic book that he's been writing, and has recently, I think, is just about to come to the end. I think there's 3 issues left. And then just progressed to the signing, really. So I got you a book signed, Michael, which will be winging its way to you.
Thank you very much.
he signed one for my dad as well for Father's Day, which is nice.
Fair play.
You know, he went out of his way to kind of chat to everybody. You know, he had a lot to say to most people by the sound of it. So that was, you know, that was pretty good. And then we just kind of got on our way. I mean, we were quite at the front of the queue, really. So he must have been signing books there for a good hour or so at least. He'd certainly been at it for a good 30 to 40 minutes by the time, you know, we came to leave. So, you know, he's really putting the miles in for his fans. And from the way that everybody was talking, I mean, there was a real buzz at the event. You know, everybody was really pleased to have been there and, you know, to have a bit of FaceTime with him. So, yeah, it was a really good event.
So are there any insights from the questions and answers that you want to share with us, things that came up there which didn't in the interview?
Yeah, it was interesting how one lady, the first person to put her hand up, couldn't quite figure out what the number plate on the front of the book said. That was a fairly awkward moment.
Yeah, fail.
Yeah, massive fail. There was questions there. One kind of referenced, you know, the influence of 80s horror fiction, books such as It, which is referenced in Nosferatu, on Joe's writing. And, you know, he said that that was kind of a conscious decision to write, you know, that kind of doorstop, blockbuster, old school horror book. The questions about Lock and Key were quite interesting as well. I'm not really particularly up to date on it myself, but I know that there has been a pilot made for Fox. And Joe confirmed, actually, that whilst the pilot will probably never see the light of day under Fox, part of that is to do with the fact that there is being an option taken up by a movie studio to potentially produce a movie trilogy of those films, which seems to be getting quite a few people really excited, actually. The guy that asked the question, you know, it would look like this was the best news he'd ever had. So I suppose that's a good thing. Obviously, in light of the fact that we'll get the Horns adaptation later on this year, I believe. So, yeah, I mean, you know, the name of Joe Hill is expanding. He's dominating the world of fiction. He's, you know, selling a lot of books. He's got a successful comic book series. And now, you know, it seems like, I mean, I don't know how much involvement he will actually have in the writing of the Lock and Key movies, but, you know, he's certainly beginning to get his tentacles out into the world of film as well. And based on, you know, how cinematic some of his writing is, I assume that can only really be a good thing.
The references to It that you mentioned are absolutely brilliant in Nosferatu, and I think that's something that we'll obviously discuss more when we're reviewing it, which will hopefully be in a couple of weeks' time.
Yep.
But yeah, is there anything else you wanted to say on the event, or is that covered it really?
Yeah, I mean, it's just, you know, it's really interesting to hear writers talk about, you know, their inspirations and where they want to kind of take their own careers and stuff like that. So, I mean, from that point of view, you know, I know that, and I'll give them a bit of a plug here because I think they do some really good events. I think that, you know, some of the Twisted Tales events, certainly in the north, and I know that that's something that we try to do in the Midlands as well, and occasionally in other places, with the This Is Horror live reading events and the chapbook launches that we do. You know, I would encourage anybody who's a fan of horror fiction, you know, to keep an eye out on the Twisted Tales blog, to keep an eye out for our events and to come out and meet people. I mean, particularly if you're a writer yourself, I mean, no matter, you know, how kind of good or how successful you are, I mean, things like this are, you know, they're so inspiring and they're so useful to hear people with the talent that Joe's got to come out and answer the questions. And it, you know, it is inspiring. So if you are a horror fiction fan, I mean, it's only something that I've started doing within the last couple of years or so, is attending these events. But, you know, people in the horror community are really approachable, really friendly, and it's, you know, it's a good place to go to get a bit of inspiration and a bit of insight into the world of the writer. So I would encourage people to keep an eye out and try and attend these events as and when they come up.
Yeah, and I'm not sure if that was intentional, but that's a brilliant way to segue into the next This Is Horror event, which is happening next Saturday. So that's Saturday, June the 8th, where we'll be launching Roadkill by Joseph DeLacy. And Joseph will also be joined by Adam Neville and Jasper Bark. And that's happening at Waterstones in Coventry. So if you're in the area, you know, come along. And if you're not, then show some dedication, like Ray Cluley and VH Leslie, who are coming all the way from Portsmouth for the event. So follow their lead.
Indeed.
I think really that wraps up what has been a short but hopefully a real informative and decent podcast. Coming up on future episodes, we're going to be reviewing the casebook of Eddie Brewer, which actually Dan recommended that we seek out that film.
Yeah, it came to me through Sam Kurt Unsworth, who knows some of the people involved. So
yeah.
He hooked me up with a review copy. I believe it's coming out on DVD soon, so we'll discuss that in more depth in an upcoming podcast.
Yeah, so listen out for that. And then, of course, there will be a Nosferatu podcast where we'll be going into detail on that and giving our ultimate verdict.
Yeah, it's nice to give people a bit of time to get through it because I believe it's about 700 pages.
Yeah.
Give yourself time to read that before you listen to the podcast, because unfortunately we will have to go into spoiler detail so to get the most out of the book.
Oh yeah, I mean it's a real doorstop of a novel. I think it's 780 pages, something like that.
Yeah.
But you know, worth reading, definitely.
Certainly a more worthwhile investment of your time than watching some of the utter shite that's, you know, coming out on the television at the moment. So get yourself a holiday book and pick up a copy of Nosferatu.
Yeah, and I mean, so I've also read Heart-Shaped Box, which is another Joe Hill book, which is well worth reading. But, I mean, if there are people listening who want a good starting point to Joe's work, where would you say to begin?
I'd say start at the beginning, to be honest, and go for 20th Century Ghosts. If you can, you can pick up a copy of that quite easily through Orion Books. It's some of the most imaginative, frightening, and just frankly wonderfully written short stories you'll find in one place. I mean, there are, I think Joe said in the interview, there are 15 stories in the book, and you know, I'd say about 13 of them would probably make it in any, you know, best new horror collection or any, you know, pick of the year anthology that you can name, really. So, you know, it's a few years old now, the book, but it's definitely worth picking up, and it's a great introduction to a guy who, as a writer, has got a fantastic range, and, you know, he's got some unique ideas.
And there are stories which kind of veer on the fantastical side, like Nosferatu.
Yeah, there are, yeah. Particular highlights in the book. I know that the story itself, 20th Century Ghost, was picked up for one of the issues of Best New Horror. There's a story in there, Pop Art, as well. Whilst not a frightening story, really, it's kind of a tale of friendship, and it does air into the fantastical, but it's an absolutely wonderful story. Just really, really worth checking out. I recommend it to anybody, any fan of horror, or just kind of well-written fiction in general, with the, you know, the edge of the fantastic, you know, fantasy or sci-fi fans, you know, the stuff in there that, you know, will push buttons for the majority of readers, would have thought.
So, there you go. Pick up a copy of 20th Century Ghost. We'll be back in a week or so, or whenever I edit a podcast together. So until then, it's goodbye from me. It's goodbye from Dan.
See ya.